Good evening, all of you. Respected Shri Ashish Nandi, Shri Balmiki Prasad Singh, Shri Alok Bansal, Dr. Suresh Goyal, and friends. I, on behalf of Legends of India, welcome you to this very interesting episode of Santa Sarabji Singh Art Appreciation Lecture Series. For those who are new to Legends of India, I take this opportunity to introduce Legends of India, a society trying to preserve the tradition of Indian cultural heritage for the younger generation, as we need to infuse in the younger generation the greatness and importance of our rich cultural heritage. During the past 17 years, we have been organizing music and theater festivals and art exhibition across the country. Our endeavor has always been about young upcoming talents to share the platform with the established legends. In the recent years, we introduced morning ragas for the inmates in Tihar and later brought it to the public domain. The crowning event of all our activities has been Legends of India Lifetime Achievement Award that was first made in 2002. And has since then gained national renown and appreciation from the cultural community. Some of the past awardees have been Zohra Sehgal, Habib Tanveer, Chandralekha, Buddhadev Das Gupta, Sitara Devi, Badal Sarkar, and Krishan Khanna, to mention a few. The Art Appreciation Lecture Series was initially conceptualized by Shanta Ji. Shanta Sarabji Singh, and therefore we have named this series in her memory. And now, with the help of Dr. Suresh Goyal, we are taking this forward. We are genuinely grateful for her determination, hard work, and total commitment. Thank you, Dr. Goyal. May I please request Shri Joy Jyoti Nandi, Member of Governing Council, Legends of India, to present a bouquet. Our panelists this evening are Shri Ashish Nandi, is a quite retired academic, functioning intellectual with two antipodal research interests, human violence and human creativity. His last three books have been The Romance of the State and The Fate of Dissent in the Tropics, Time Tricks and The Resumes of Narcissism and Resumes of Despair. Shri Balmiki Prasad Singh, he has been Governor of Sikkim, India during 2008-13. He is a distinguished scholar, thinker, public servant. He is well known as the author of Baudha Approach, which outlines a path towards a harmonious world as against the class of civilization. Shri Alok Bansal is the Executive Director of the South Asian Institute for Strategic Affairs. He has been the executive director of the National Maritime Foundation and has worked with the Institute of Defense Studies and Analysis and the Center for Land Warfare Studies earlier. He has authored a book titled Balochistan in Turmoil, Pakistan at Crossroads in 2009 and has co-edited several other books. Ladies and gentlemen, over to Dr. Goyal.
Thank you, Lisa. Good evening to all of you. I must say that after all the rains and everything, the storm and the havoc on the roadside, thank you very much. It's really great to see you here, to brave the weather outside and listen to this, what I think should be a very, very exciting and inspiring discussion. For many, as Lisa said, that this forum is all about really discussing, investigating certain ideas about cultural thought, certain civilizational ideas, and culture not purely in the sense of what you see on the stage, the performing culture, whether it's visual or dance or music or anything. But I think you would agree that culture is really more about thoughts. Culture is more about what you are. Culture is your identity. Culture is what defines you. So unless we understand what that identity is, what the thought is, rest of it really probably to me would be meaningless, unless we understand what actually goes behind it. And therefore, for me, actually, personally, the thought that goes behind, the thought about what Indian culture is all about, is more important, at least equally important, if not more, than as compared to what you see there on the stage. Now, I think when you have listened to the curriculum vitae of the panelists, they're all very highly eminent speakers in their own areas, and the subject has been told to you. I think you will know what this is about, really. But when I was thinking about what we should discuss today evening, and I thought of the subject as globalization of in culture and Indian ethos, the idea that I had in mind is that whenever we talk about Indian culture, we really cannot think but a global context. For us, culture has never been defined in a narrow sense of really just either an Indus Valley civilization or what happened 2000 or Vedic civilization, etc., etc. But culture has been really what includes or pervades entire humanity. When we say Vasudev Kutumbakam, we never limited it to just Bharatvarsh. It went beyond. When we talked about Sarve Bhavantu Sukhina, you know, we are actually talking about humanity. We are talking about Bharatvarsh, but in the context of where it belongs. For us, Vasudha has been the beginning point, really, for what we stand for. But that was a time, I would believe, that when, for us, the culture was not about becoming supreme or becoming powerful, but culture was basically something which actually was the epitome of whatever we were. And therefore, in a sense, India could be considered to be a spiritual power, could be considered to be a civilizational focus of the world. But nonetheless, it was important. It was important basically because we were actually giving ideas universally to the world. And that is where it came from. So there was a sense of empowerment, the sense of strength that we were speaking from. On the other hand, there have been episodes in the Indian history when we have actually tried to submerge ourselves into different kinds of ideas just to essentially, I would call it survival techniques. For example, I mean, on the one hand, the influences of the Arabic and the Persian civilizations and the British and the European civilization, on the one hand, it enriched us. On the other hand, my own belief is that it was a survival tactic. If we cannot overcome them, be one of them, or at least adjust. When there's a pushback, you adjust to the different ideas, and you survive. So in a sense, that was both survival and there was both enrichment. Then we have Vivekananda in the modern times, who goes and redefines what Indianism. I'm not using the other words because I know that it's going to create a whole lot of political debate, but let us say Indianism. He goes to Chicago and redefines the whole Indianism in a very inclusive sort of manner. And the message of what India stands for again becomes very, very clear. On the other hand, just before that, you have Shankaracharya. One is talking about basically a unitary nature of Indian culture or Indian civilization. The other is talking about a multiplicity of the Indian culture. At the same time, there is this kind of multiple identities. We don't actually even, or we are, if I can use the word confused, not confused really, but we are perplexed. We don't know what actually we are all about. So I think there is a whole lot of issues when we talk about Indian ethos in the context of globalization. which primarily defined us before. So I think to discuss these subjects and these issues, we cannot have a better panel than this. Dr. B.P. Singh, he was governor of Sikkim, but more than that, I know him as culture secretary. I've known him as the home secretary, and he knows India, what it stands for. Dr. Ashish Nandi, I think one cannot even say anything about him. It's going to be inspiring, and the good thing about him is that he challenges conventional wisdom. So we are waiting to hear from him. And Alok Bansal, he belongs to the strategic area, but you cannot have culture divorced from strategic discussions. They both really come together in a sense. So we will start with you, sir, Mr. Dr. Singh, and then Ashish, you, and Alok, you. 10 minutes each to present your thoughts, after which we go into the discussions amongst ourselves and the audiences. Sir, you can speak from here, from the podium, wherever you want.
Interesting title. This seems to be a very interesting title, Globalization of Culture and Indian Ethos. I'm in the company of Sri Ashish Nandi, Sri Alok Bansal, and of course, Ambassador Goel. I take this opportunity, since I'm the first speaker, to pay my homage to the memory of Santaji, whom I knew and also had the pleasure of meeting her husband on a few occasions. Both of them are no more. This topic is very beautifully crafted, Globalization of Culture and Indian Ethos. There is something eternal about India's culture. For the last 5,000 years and more, despite invasions, wars, intermingling of ideas, religions, India has remained a distinct cultural identity. And whether you are in India or outside, there is something unique in this culture which gives you an identity. And we have been like that in succeeding generations. I was putting this idea in the context of globalization, which means upscaling India's thought processes in terms of new technologies, trade, and new inventions. Now, what is this India's culture? I must make a distinction which you all know, but I thought I must clarify. Culture and civilization are distinguishable concepts. Civilization is much wider than culture. Whether culture is indestructible, civilizations have decline, decay, and death. And when I say that culture is permanent, eternal, it is best expressed in the Sanskrit word, Sanskriti, which is a process of refinement. And when I say this, I am aware of scholars who think that there is no one Indian culture. Now it will be very, very ridiculous in my view to view India's culture in terms of Christian culture or Muslim culture or Hindu culture and so on and so forth. Then there are people who say, what is then that culture? A culture which has 33 million gods and goddesses?
Yes.
330 million. And each one gets venerated from time to time. No one is discarded. What is that uniqueness? So I have coined a phraseology for that when describing India's culture. That is, I'm comparing it with honey or with comparing with nectar or something of a kind of an essence that refines you, that uplifts you, that gives you distinctiveness, that gives you character. So there are two ways. One is the ant way. Chitya, they collect particles of sugar or sweet from different places and put it at one place. But each one is distinguishable. Then there are bees. They take nectar from different plants, make a beehive, and you have the honey. So I say it is the bee activity that denotes India's culture. I have served in different parts of India. I have known Indian diaspora in different places of the world. It tastes differently. When you see India's culture on the bank of Brahmaputra or on the bank of Kaveri, it may be different, but it's India's culture. It is indistinguishable. It has myriad expressions and all kinds of things which you can say, painting, dance, drama, Bollywood films, yoga exercises. These are the manifestations of India's culture, well known all the world over. And therefore, so long India supports and multiplies bee activity, so long you and I become agents of that bee activity in culture, India's culture, India's process of refinement of society and its values remains permanent. Let me put it in the context of globalization. You know, we are living in a post-Second World War political, social, economic architecture. But things are changing. The world is in transition. And it started with the fall of Berlin Wall in 1989 and dissolution of the Soviet Union in 1991. These were the two major events. So we were pushed into in the post-Cold War world. And then there were different views of culture and civilization. Here, I'm using this word both, knowing clearly the distinction. One was the point of view of Fukuyama, you must have heard, who said this is the end of history. The other view was of Huntington. I too joined the issue, and I said that after the fall of Berlin Wall and dissolution of the Soviet Union and all that in the post-Cold War world, military, which was the most important factor in determining the status of the country, has been given a second position, and market or economy has become number one. Economic factors have become number one. So it is now economic, military. And then I advocated that culture has emerged as the third important factor. And I talked of culture giving unity of thought and action, starting dialogue among civilizations. which is the Indian way of looking at it. Because, you know, we were told by Mahatma Gandhi, trained generations, I belong to a family of freedom fighters, father, grandfather, and all that, that we don't hate the British. We dislike the colonial exploitative mechanism that the British had transplanted on India. But this was not there in other countries of Asia and Africa and even Latin America, which got independence from the colonial rules led by the British and other European powers. They had hatred. And Huntington became right in saying that he could see that anger, he could see that hate, because there was no civilizing cultural force. And that was used, and you know, 9/11 and post thereafter. So it's proved wrong. And I knew that had been proved wrong, but I had not given up. So I had attended a conference in Washington after 9/11, and they asked that India has that ethos of pluralism, and India may have the answer. Because I was then the executive director of the World Bank. And I said, while India may have the answer, I don't have. And then came over to think over what is India's answer. And then after a lot of research, it took me 4 years, and visits to, for 41 to villages of India, to come across this concept, which is well known to you, but I have put it in a different fashion. Ekam sat vipra bahudha badanti. Truth is one, but the sages have described it variously. I said, the problem lies in ekam sad. The moment you say one truth, which is valid, I'm not disputing the validity of one truth and quest for it. I'm said, the moment you say one truth, one person says, my truth is the real truth. My God is the most powerful God. My scripture is the best. My folklores and folk tales gives you the best way of shaping your life and behavior. And the problem arises. And problem is taking place today also. Sects of the same religion are in conflict. Religions are in conflict. So what is the answer? So I said the answer is in Bahudha. Celebrate all, and that is Indian ethos. We have celebrated all thoughts, thought processes. We have welcomed thoughts to come from all sides. And I got strength from the villages. Most of the scholars and even other people, they think Vasudhaiv Kutumbakam was in some Ved or Upanishad or something. No, it is not there. It was the dialogue of the people. There is no author. It was incorporated in Hitopadesh. So look at the people. Look at that cultural milieu which produced this concept. Why I'm saying this is, Bahudha has two components. One is clear, Bahudha means pluralism, but it's more than that. It says that you have to respect everyone. Why? But it requires another concept which I have added, that while I'm talking to you, I have a point of view, but I have also an attitude of mind to hear you with respect, because you may perhaps be right. So what is that Indian ethos that should be our guide in modern globalized world, that should give India a path? And then I found that the idea of India and Indian ethos are inseparable. These are two different concepts. They have a close relationship. What is that idea of India in terms of Indian ethos? The idea of India rests on democracy, secularism, diversity, and pluralism. I repeat, the idea of India rests on democracy, secularism, diversity, and pluralism. So, there is need to redefine moral and social concepts, to reshape political idioms, to meet the challenges of today. Globalization of India's culture, or Indian culture, has to be done in a manner that takes India forward, that does not make it inward-looking, that refines every Indian, every child, to feel proud of this ethos. And it is a dynamic process. It is not a static concept. It is not confined to something which makes you small, which makes you feel guilty, either in terms of law or in terms of forms of worship. It must lift you. It must link itself with the idea of India, and that is what I wanted to tell you by way of the beginning of the speech. Thank you.
I hope I have not exceeded.
Thank you.
The time. I was worried about your time.
Normally, I would have tried to interject with a few remarks, but in the interest of keeping time, I think we will keep all the discussions and the remarks at the end, after the speeches. Ashish, may I request you? And again, from here or from the lectern, wherever.
That was a marvelous introduction to the idea of culture, and Dr. Singh presented. I have nothing to argue about in that case. But I am getting old, and I'm a grumpy old man, you can call me. And I work on the nastiest side of life most of the time. So I will come to this problem in a different way. Because the theme, basic theme, is the relationship between globalization and culture. Firstly, the matter of culture. I agree with Dr. Singh's presentation, and particularly his definition of culture, but I do want to distinguish amongst three concepts of culture. There are many concepts of culture. One anthropologist has gone so far as to enumerate 19 concepts of culture current only in the discipline of anthropology, and then went on to write a fat book on one of them. So, culture has many connotations. I think in our world, in this part of the world, we are primarily concerned with three kinds of culture. One kind of culture is what Dr. Singh talks about. And I'm very grateful to him for elucidating that. In fact, he talks of two of them. The second one is implicit. The first is culture as what we could call possibly high culture, what you see on the stage. Shanta Sarvajit Rai, Sarvajit Singh, all her life spent studying that culture. What could we put on the proscenium stage? And that also is a valuable part of culture. Many of our classical art forms are also now available to you because of that version of culture. I'm very proud of that version of culture, but that is not the only way of culture. Dr. Singh has also talked about, as he made it clear, I want to distinguish between the two clearly, culture as a kind of algorithm of everyday life, which is within us, and yet not only us. It connects you to a community. To have that kind of culture, you must have a community. It is the community which holds up this culture and gives it certain coherence and meaning in everyday life. Some forms of art also falls within that. They have not yet come to the larger market, so to speak. Only a few days ago, I heard a presentation on Meena art. And previously, I have not seen Meena art. This is the one first person who has studied it extensively. And some of the slides he showed us was absolutely exhilarating. And he doesn't want to expose this to the world too much, because he says it is integrated with the lives of the Meenas, in particularly in rural Rajasthan, so much that once you do it, it will go the way of some other art forms thrown up by the tribal India, by tribal India, Madhubani paintings, Valli paintings, and so on and so forth, and will be immediately be marketized. And the role that it plays as a consolidating agent that holds together a community in Meenas will be, at least that part will be lost. It will become more individualistic, more competitive game, as has happened with many other art forms. I don't want to go to that part of it. So the second part of culture is that where it is part of integrated life. And that does not include only art forms. That includes also the way we think about things, the way we behave with each other, the whole human relationships we have in the communities, the language we speak, and the overall rhythm of life, if you like to call it so. It is that. That is the culture which is also very important. And finally, culture can be seen, this also was implied in Dr. Singh's presentation, as a part of a civilization. When he talks of India, he invokes a civilization, which is in dynamic, it's a dynamic sense system where different kinds of cultures are interacting. And that interaction, that contact zone, is a zone of creativity. Because it is that clash of cultures, it is the dynamics released by that interaction which throws up new ideas, new forms of creativity, new epistemic interventions, and so on and so forth. So these three parts of culture are very important. And at a part of that, I will also say that the principle of culture there is to vet or scan, if you like, on behalf of a community, what it will take, what it will reject. This is an important part of that function. It cannot take at face value whatever is coming to as a good intrusion, a valuable input. It must decide what to react to and in which way. So culture has that role too. Culture as resistance, you can call it. Now, globalization is a different kettle of fish. We always talk about globalization as if it has been discovered in the 1990s in India and a little earlier in the Western world. It is mainly the globalization of financial capital. Everybody knows that globalization. I see this at the third stream of globalization. The first attempt to globalize the world was not as widespread as this. It was the Atlantic slave trade. It was a four-continent slave trade. Do not forget that. It took a toll of, new estimates suggest, something like 12 million lives. And that does not take into account the communities destroyed, the families destroyed in Africa, and the languages destroyed. It was a devastating experience for the African continent. And if that was probably the most ambitious globalization, because if you can buy and sell human beings in the market, nothing can be sacrosanct for you later on. After that, this globalization looks a pale shadow of globalization. That's the real globalization, I would say. The second globalization came when modern colonialism entered the picture. I say modern because colonization was an experience which Asians, Africans, and South Americans have faced for something like at least 450 years, if not 500 years. But the earlier colonizations were in the style of marauding military ventures from which we have seen from ancient times. It was that colonialism's main purpose was loot and also cheap labor. Spain and Portugal specialized in that. They were justified by the Pope, who gave a bull which country should be called belong to Portugal, which should belong to Spain, where the Spaniards have a right to go, where the Portuguese have a right to go, and so on and so forth. So that was another kind of colonialism. The modern colonialism was a different kind. England and France specialized in that. In England's colonies, the sun never set. It's a country which small countries, not probably in population, I think it is 1/8 of India. It dominated the entire world virtually. And India was never ruled by more than 50,000 English. So, but this colonialism has a different kind of ambition. It has a civilizing mission. It wanted to civilize us. And I would suggest that at one point, Indian culture provided a contact zone. And really, this colonialism did release certain new kind of forces which were creative and were healthy. Namely, there was nothing called novel in India. They introduced the concept of novel. And I think it met a certain cultural requirement. That particular form of writing was very important. And that is why today, if you take the first list of the most famous novelists, at least 1/3 of them will be Indian. And first 10 if you take it. So that is, India has made the novel their own, exactly as some African writers have done too, that same thing. So there was this need for that kind of thing, which was not made by our concept of epics and other things. But colonialism also brought in the idea of civilization, which organized and institutionalized ways of educating people, ways of thinking, and ways of redefining communities. And believe in that community. We, after independence, we have not shed that part of the thing. And however much we like some of the words we use today, the fact of the matter is this. These words are all double-edged swords for a large section of our people, certainly a majority of our people, however nice and beautiful they might look to us. At one time, we sought our certitudes from religion. Now also many people will say religion is very prominent in public life, particularly in countries like India. But this is actually not the same religion. Because the religion that existed earlier, which gave you certitudes, were in some sense, you can call it faith. People believed in something. People believed in divinities and a divine disposition. They believed that the earth was permeated by the touch of the divine, and crucial sectors of life had sanctity and could be considered sacred. I mean, to give you an example, childhood was sacred. Krishna as a Rajan in Mahabharata is not as sacred as Balakrishna in all parts of India. No, childhood had sanctity of a certain kind. That is gone, as you can, if you read your newspapers regularly, you will see that. You don't have to mention that. The concept of femininity, particularly associated with reproductivity, as opposed to productivity, had a certain kind of priority, certain kind of serious implications, because in a sense, in an agricultural society, the idea of femininity mediated between nature and human being. Nature also was sacred. That sanctity nature has lost. You can read it in the newspapers. I don't have to tell you about that. Yeah. From that world, we have come into a world where the older sanctities are eroded. We are coming to the world where we don't have that relationship with the divine and the faith. Now, faiths, for that matter, gods and goddesses do not protect you. You protect gods and goddesses. That's the main difference between religion as it exists today in public life and religion as it existed earlier. At that time, gods and goddesses protected you. This is what Vivekananda dreamt in a temple in Kashmir when he went to pray in a Kali temple at that. And he said, Mother, why you have been subjected to such humiliation by conquerors and others? Should we protect you? And he heard, in his vision, he heard Kali saying to him, do you protect me or do I protect you? I think that's a question we can ask to a lot of people who today try to protect religion and the gods and goddesses of India today. But that's a different story. I don't want to go into that. Now, I just want to end by reminding you that today, increasingly, it is the last meaning of culture, which I almost mentioned casually, culture as a form of resistance has become extremely important. Because all around us we see the communities which held together these cultures, Dr. Singh has referred to that also, are increasingly under attack. Because a modern nation state, for the sake of efficiency, control and management, today doesn't want an intervening, mediating presence within individuals and the state. Increasingly, we are seeing, not only in India, in large parts of the world, even when this full-fledged democracy, under a democratic governance also, the individual stands naked in front of the state. Because one by one, we are either demolished or weakened all the intervening structures. All the intervening structures. We have nothing to fall back on, nothing which will speak on our behalf as a community. And I want to draw your attention to the fact that in the last, and just to give you one example, there was only in one census, we were honest enough to really ask the people, what is the language, what is your mother tongue? And that census showed that India had 1,500 languages. 40 years after that census, 35 or 40 years after that, Ganesh Devi, a linguist himself, mounted a people's survey of languages in India only 2 years ago. And the results show that only 1,200 languages survive now. 300 has died in the last 40 years. India has 1,500 languages, now it has 1,200 languages. It is a country of enormous diversity, that also he has mentioned. But few people mention that diversity itself is our saving grace. That diversity also means that we are living in a cultural world where forms of resistance are there, where we can bank upon. We can use or exploit or rediscover. That part of the story has to be narrated. And unfortunately, we have found new divinities. As the old religious thought, faiths have died out, religion has become a religious ideology. So, and it includes now new divinities. And some of them are nation state, development, the idea of progress. Each of these ideas are a way of dividing the people of those who are developed and underdeveloped, the progressive and the backward, the secular and the non-secular, and so on. So I don't want to shock you here at the moment, but I was just forcing you to think that each of them have become tools of dividing people. So in India, there is a great debate on nobody now says that I don't believe in secularism. There is now difference between genuine secularists and pseudo-secularists. In every step, that those who are for development or against development. So we, in the meanwhile, while arguing on this, we have built 12,000 dams, 380 of them large dams. Yes, I'm just finishing. All I want to tell you that we have to learn with a touch of robust skepticism in the world in which we live. I'm not a pessimist, I'm optimistic that Indian culture will survive. But we will also have to recognize that the culture we are talking of is not only the high culture. Not even this civilization always lived with an undersight and a margin. And and that dynamic of the civilization partly dependent on that. We probably have to look at the marginalized and substratum of Indian civilization to reinvent ourselves. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry, Ashish, it was beautiful, but I'm sorry. In interest of, hello?
Thank you, Ambassador Goyal. At the outset, let me clarify, I'm neither a sociologist nor an anthropologist, and culture to me is as alien as anything else. When an outsider approaches culture, the first question that comes to mind is, what is culture? And you have different definitions of culture. You have sociologists, the way they look at culture. You have anthropologists, the way they look at culture. And as Ashish Nandi said, there are 19 different ingredients. One anthropologist found in culture and wrote a big book on it. Politicians have another way of looking at culture. Political scientists look at it in a different way. Theologists look at culture in a different way. But we all know what culture is. We may not be able to define it, but we all know probably what culture is. The way I dress, the way I eat, these are all ingredients of culture. As I said, I'm not a sociologist and I'm not a scholar. I feel deeply humbled to be in the company of intellectual giants like Dr. B.P. Singh and Ashish Nandi. I'll give my perspective of globalization of culture and Indian ethos. Since I'm not a sociologist, I won't delve much into culture, but more on globalization of culture. But be that as it may be, what is culture? In fact, I tried to look up certain definitions because I couldn't define it. And I found one definition saying the art and other manifestation of human intellectual achievements regarded collectively. That didn't sound perfectly. Another definition, which to my mind is somewhat similar, is the ideas, customs, and social behavior of a particular people or society. Now that, to some extent, clicks. And if culture itself is so difficult to define, then how do you define Indian culture? It's a deeply controversial issue. Because Ambassador Goyal had to use Indianism in Vivekananda's speech. I've heard that speech a number of times. I couldn't find that Indianism, the word, anywhere. So obviously, there is some controversy associated with culture, the Indian culture. That's why probably Hinduism has become Indianism or something like that. So Indian culture define.
I was leaving all that to you.
No, no. Indianism itself, as I said, Indian culture. So what is Indian culture? Now defining it is as difficult as defining culture is. But to me, what is certainly the ingredients of Indian culture is liberalism. Now somebody will say, well, how is that? Because a society that accepted Draupadi, that accepted Kunti, was definitely a liberal society. It was a society that was believed in secularism. And when I say secularism, I don't believe in pseudo-secularism or genuine secularism. But secularism as defined in West is quite different from Indian secularism, because Western secularism is la diniyat, as Arabs or Persians define it, absence of religion. Whereas in Indian secularism, as we define it, it's sarvadharma sammana. We believed that there could be different paths to the same goal way. And as a result, if you are a Vedanti, you could be a Karmakandi. You didn't believe in God, that was also acceptable. You could be a Charvaka. Now, Charvaka said that life is meant to be enjoyed and not to do anything else. He talked of object material enjoyment. So everything was accepted. Mao may have said that let 100 contrasting, contending ideologies coexist during the 100 flower blooms. But I think ancient India definitely believed in those 100 contrasting, contending ideologies coexisting. So that is part of Indian culture. Another, of course, is globalization, and I won't delve into it because Vasudev Kutumbakam has been talked of so much of time. We believed that the whole world was one world, and that's what we did it. The beauty of Indian culture is that it spread, and it spread organically across the world, did not try to uproot other cultures. There was many other cultural spreads. As Ashish said, certain people came to civilize others. When you try to civilize others, you uproot their culture and plant your culture. We did not try to do that. We moved there and we integrated with the local cultures. And you'll find it in Southeast Asia and different ages. It moved through trade and spirituality. We did not conquer lands to actually spread our culture. Having said that, let me focus on what is my main focus is globalization of Indian culture and ethos, which has actually spread. And has it globalized? To my mind, undoubtedly. If two or three decades ago, I would go to a Western capital or a Western city, I would starve because I was a vegetarian, couldn't get a single dish. Today, you cannot go to a big city in the world where you wouldn't find Indian cuisine. That's also part of Indian culture. You have Indian restaurant everywhere. So Indian culture is globalizing. Now, this process of globalization has taken place in phases. When you say Indian culture or ethos has globalized, what basically we are looking is the spread of Indian culture outside the geographical frontiers of India. And I would like to divide it into four or five parts. The first aspect is South Asia, which is actually nothing but a cultural homogeneous entity. It's only politically divided, so you can say. Probably the culture which exists in Pakistan, Bangladesh, Nepal, Bhutan, Sri Lanka is actually part of that same homogeneous entity, that what we call it as Indian culture. The second is where Indian culture spread long, long back, like Southeast Asia. When you go to Bali, when you go to Da Nang in Vietnam, in central Vietnam, Champas, you go to Angkor Wat, you see manifestation of Indian culture. The other day I was in Yangon and a lady said, well, I have known right from beginning what are Vedas. We know Vedas. We were taught during the colonial period what the Vedas, etc. were. So everybody knows. You go to a Hindu temple in Myanmar, you'll find the Chinese and Burmese are more in numbers than probably Indians. So that is integration. We never try to supplant it. You could be this, you could be this, you could follow this policy, you could do that. And that was there. And that existed. So that was the first wave of globalization when Southeast Asia, Indian culture spread to that area. The next major spread or globalization of Indian culture to my mind was because of indenture. Ashish talked of slavery. When slavery ended, indenture started. We had the Girmitias. Moved to Fiji, moved to Suriname, moved to Trinidad, moved to Guyana, moved to South Africa, moved to Mauritius. With that went Indian culture. These countries have Indian culture. You go there, in fact, some of them have preserved it in a more pristine form than what exists today in India. So that was the next phase. The next phase was migration. Migration of Indians who moved in search of better livelihood, moved to Western countries, and that's how Indian culture started spreading. And when this diaspora, which had moved, when a diaspora grew in strength, the Indian culture also became far more acceptable in those countries, the Western countries, the Europe, the Australia, the New Zealand, and that's it. And now we are breaching the final frontiers. There was a society behind the iron curtains, which was actually kept in seclusion. Now Indian culture is crossing across those final barriers. I was in Kunming the other day, in Yunnan, and a taxi driver who could speak not a word of English was playing a song from Three Idiots. In Sichuan and Kunming, if you could manage to convince a person that you know yoga, that man would prostrate before you. That is the pull, that is the strength of Indian culture. The final bastion is cracking. Just on last Saturday, in Beijing, people were singing kirtans at a SCON function. So that shows Indian culture is moving. The last bastion behind the... Because what has happened is, the traditional Marxist orthodoxy has actually cracked up. China is a communist state, but communist only in name. People are looking for spiritual moorings. Because unlike in the past, when Marxism provided that spiritual mooring, they're looking for that yearning for that spiritual mooring. And as a result, you find people are actually looking for that sort of a spirituality. And as a result, today, yes, Indian culture has globalized. It's probably spread to every nook and corner of the globe. And what are the instruments of this globalization? To my mind, there are few very, very powerful instruments of this globalization. One is, of course, the diaspora. Because diaspora took the culture, people saw that culture, and as the diaspora grew of age, your culture became acceptable. Because as Indian diaspora's stature improved, Indian culture also became niche. Earlier it was probably looked down upon. So diaspora. Then of course our soft power, instruments of soft power, yoga, spirituality. Now, spirituality is nothing to be ashamed of. Today, the world is looking at Indian spirituality, and I'm not talking of religion, because religion and dharma, again, are two different things. Very difficult to conjoin them. And to that extent, yoga, spirituality, and finally, I think I'm being told to wind up. So, and finally, one of the most powerful instruments of spread of Indian culture is the films. And especially in Oriental countries. In fact, because all said and done, there have been certain subtle differences between the Orient and the Occident. Oriental societies are family-centric. Occidental societies are individual-centric. And that's one of the reasons why Indian films have hit it so well in China. They don't allow more than 8 films to be actually released. But Three Idiots was a hit. Dangal was the largest grosser non-Hollywood film in China. And Dangal's record was broken in 3 days by Hindi medium. So that's the level of popularity because Chinese relate to it. It's the same culture. The cultural ethos are similar. And with that, I think I'd just like to take my place. I said Indian culture is globalizing. It's giving strength. And this Indian soft power actually strengthens India. As Dr. B.P. Singh said, the military probably is no longer the most important ingredient. Economics and culture have become far more important as far as a country's influence in the world today is concerned. Thank you.
Actually, we were not talking about you exceeding time. Ashish had to leave. So this is what we were talking about. But, Ashish, are you sure that you have to leave now? You cannot wait for 10 minutes? Okay. No, I understand. I understand. Okay. Because we are going to take up the points that you had made. Anyway, well, thank you very much, sir, you and Ashish, who is now leaving, but and Alok. Several interesting points have been made actually in the different points. I'm not going to really elaborate much because I think this is an occasion when there should be an interaction between the panelists and the audience. But some Certain interesting points that I must really point out. Interesting thesis, sir, Bahudha, whether actually when we say Ekam Satya, whether that Ekam Satya really represents what we believe in. Because Ekam Satya, if we really say that truth is only one, it can prove to be divisive. But unlike what we have said that yes, there is one God, but we can speak about God in different ways. So I think that could be diversity. The idea really for me would be that the thoughts can be common, usually common thoughts, but the language is different. The ways you express the thoughts are different. So multiplicity of ways, Allah and Khuda and Bhagwan, they are only one entity. But nonetheless, yes, if we insist on one truth, can it be divisive? I don't know. Ashish has left now, but there was one interesting thing, and I remembered we had a discussion. Sir, I'm going to open it up to the... Ashish made an interesting point about connecting to the community. Very true. But we had a discussion on spirituality and secularism in culture. The idea that recurred over and over again is that secularism, as Indian secularism, which basically is more inclusive rather than saying that, yes, no belief in religion. I think that's an impossible thing. We all believe in something or the other. You call it whatever it is. Even the Marxists, they believe in Marxism. For them, so there is a faith. But the idea is whether my faith will exclude your faith or it will not. Multiplicity, I think there is secularism. And that is where you found the spirituality was really a strong thread underrunning our own systems of civilization and culture. And then Ashish, I think the point really is we need to examine that culture is the scanning that is used on behalf of the community to know what it can accept and what it can reject. I think that's a very, very strong, yes, but also full of, fraught with certain risks, as we are seeing at the moment. And then, Alok, yes, diaspora, the Indian community living abroad, the congruence between the economic success and the popularity of the Indian culture. I've seen it happen myself. As we are becoming more successful abroad, professionally and economically, we are becoming more acceptable, and there is a greater manifestation of this, you know, the visible face of Indian culture. Sir, at this stage, I just wanted to basically point out, but this is going to be open to the conversation between the panelists and the ideas from the floor. Just please raise your hands, introduce yourself, and yes. If there's a microphone here, please.
Or you can come here.
But usually we have the microphones, but...
My question is about something that none of the three panelists really touched upon much, and it's the international influences on Indian culture. And I'm not talking about high culture, but I'm talking about the other things that Professor Nandi brought up, which is the algorithm of everyday life. And he talked about how you know, we are losing things like sanctity of childhood, et cetera, et cetera. But he was talking more about domestic influences that did that. But you know, if you look at what is happening, there's a kind of, I think India's influence on the world is, I think, far less than the world's influence on India. I mean, and I'd want the panel to, I mean, some of the panelists to talk about it. That, you know, if you look at, Mr. Bansal pointed this out, that, you know, we have Oriental families and Occidental families, but, you know, really, if you look at Indian families today, they're far more, you know, you look at the more nuclear families, and some of that whole tradition of a family-based society is going away. There's almost everyone, ways of being have influenced us. You know, people are always saying thank you to each other. I remember my parents never said, I love you, but there was a lot of love. And now I hear young parents, you know, always telling their kids, you know, ooh, we love you. But they're actually most of the time neglecting their children. So I was hoping that...
Can you give your name?
Yeah, my name is Daljeet Singh.
I would just like to mention that this is not a Q&A session, really. It's a discussion and conversation. So please feel free, sir, whenever or Alok, whenever you want to make a remark and say so. Please.
I thought it was a very nice question. You know, we have to realize that our civilizational processes denied education to a large section of people and the women, not for 100 years, but for 1,000 years. And so the capacity of the community to challenge in the face of the onslaught of values from Western countries cannot be that powerful, because we don't know the consequences of everything. Now look at one company which has come in the news. Apple or Samsung, almost in every village you go, there will be some shop. That name is there. Now, it links that village, that community, to the rest of the community, the rest of society. I was governor of Sikkim, I went to supervise. To see, in fact, not to supervise, to see that everything after earthquake is there. So when I landed from the helicopter, I had earlier said that Boy Scouts should see that food packets, etc., medicines reach the victims. So they said a very good arrangement. So I said, do you have any problem? He said, yes, mobile phones are not working. Now, I would welcome that. And this was an education to me. I have been a deputy commissioner, supervised relief operations. But see how you can call it international influence. That doesn't mean that it is an evil influence. Now, when Brahmins were persecuted in Tamil Nadu, again, social tension between the Brahmins and the backwards. Some came to Delhi, some went to Bombay, elsewhere, but some went to the United States, the brighter ones. And the Boston Brahmins, as they are known today, they revolutionized the information communications technology. That was the innate strength of Indian culture that made them do so. As they say, popularly, there is one British scholar who said, Indian culture, but I'm talking about the Brahminical and the Buddhist, the Jain culture of the past. They went, as you said, to various countries of Southeast Asia. They said, this is one country in the world which has not sent the sword, but which has sent the spirit. So that empire of the spirit, we would be in that position. Dr. Nandi said, and rightly so, we have not invented anything much. Because you look at 50% of population there. If we had this meeting, say even 50 years back in this hall, I don't think many ladies would have been here at 8 p.m. None might have come here.
50 years
Huh?
But before that, maybe not.
And that may not. That's what I'm saying. Oh, yeah, 100 years. Yeah. No, in Delhi, but not in other places. In Assam, yes. But not in Bihar. Things are changing in different places. Assam, where I worked, the women didn't have this kind of problem, which I saw in Bihar. So what I'm saying that I agree with you, 100 years say. Things are changing. And if this is called westernization, foreign culture is dominating over us, let it dominate. Let it release, help us release the latent energies of the people. Let every person in India get the best possible education. And let him try his luck. But I'm unhappy about that point that you rightly made about the family systems, value systems breaking down. Oh, it's terribly breaking down. Terribly. And it is really, because the community doesn't have, as Mr. Nandi said, the power to resist. Do you have any additional question? I will ask. You answer, then I will ask.
Bahudha. Also respond.
Just a few issues which I thought I think. Change is, I think, inevitable. One culture doesn't mean that culture is static. Because with the passage of time, things obviously evolve. The second part is, I don't agree that the Western culture has influenced us more than Indian culture has influenced the world. To my mind, I think India has been the center of the culture, actually. In fact, there's a very interesting statement which the famous Indologist Axel Michels had called. He said, India is world's cultural heritage. And I think we have also given to the world. Westernization, yes, is taking place. And again, a slight difference of opinion. Ancient India women were educated. If you actually look at it, Shankaracharya's the famous Shastrarth with Mandan Mishra, the adjudicator was his wife. So if you look at it, so it was there. In between, there was a period when there was probably some aberrations when we didn't have. But despite that, yes, at all these periods, there was never a time when women were completely shut down. Even during the Muslim period, you had Razia Sultan ruling over Delhi Sultanate. You had large number of queens. You had Durgavati during Akbar's time. We had, they were minuscule, but the society completely did not shut them down. There was, of course, aberrations. As I said, women were kept inside. The caste system actually accelerated, which was again aberrations into the society. But when I talked of family, you said Oriental family and Occidental family. My question was not that. I was trying to say that when an Occidental individual thinks about, it's more an individual centric. Me, myself. Whereas Oriental context, we look at a family. I'm not talking of a joint family or something. It may be a nuclear family, whatever it is. But for us, family is still very important. Whereas in the West, by and large, now it's becoming individual. Me, myself. That is what I was just trying to say. Now, there may be some differences on that.
Yes. All right. I see many. Please do use a microphone if you can.
Hello, I'm Sudha Sachdeva. I teach at Lady Irwin College. I teach development communication. And these are all the issues we are dealing with at, great length in the kind of discourses that we have with our students and in the kind of work that we are doing. Though I'm not a trained anthropologist, but we have interest in the diverse areas. All I'm trying to say that we started with Vasudev Kutumbakam as the concept that the whole world is family, individuals. Dr. Nandi shed light on the various divisive forces and factors. Absolutely true. The fact that today we are not only diverse culture, but facing multifaceted attacks economically, politically, globally, and our family was the basic unit from which we all sprang. Society comes from each of us. We are all a part of the same society. And if you're all wanting to become only individuals, I mean, you never survive as individual. And American family kamzor hai, wo India ki taraf family ko leke shayad, inspiration thoda sa dekhte hain. Jo unka concept of religion hai, wo bahut alag hai. And for us, we were always above religion to spirituality, respecting every life form. Not only humans, but birds, animals, insects. Purane zamane mein aap dekhte the, log cheetiyon ko dana dalte hain. Kyun? It's human responsibility. Na, aap kisi ko feed kar rahe. Now that coexistence, that respect for every being, every life form is lost. Families are disintegrating. Families mein communication nahi hai. Aap dunia ko kahan le jaoge? Yeah, le ja rahe. We may have, you know, physical visibility in terms of restaurants and all, and businessmen traveling all over the world, Indian talent traveling all over the world, and you know, creating a place for themselves. Great, fine, nothing wrong with that. But that selection of good from all over the world, preserving that, and getting rid of the bad, whether your own country or from outside, having a stable resistance is what Dr. Nandi said, is somewhere we need to, you know, build those resistance within the families. Family se hi samaj badalta, samaj se desh aur desh se duniya. Somewhere is just one of the perceptions I want to, you know, contribute to the discussion. I hope it's useful.
Thank you. Are there any more remarks from the floor, sir? Because we have only 5 or 10 minutes left. So let us see. Yes.
That's very good.
Yes. Here, and then there was a hand over there. It's useful. They are, I think, also.
Good evening, and thank you for the talk. My question is related to what Sri Nandi earlier said and made a distinction between the high culture and the actual lived experience of people in India, in modern India. So, you know, we have had a tradition of human rights. We have had a tradition of protecting those who were persecuted. Zoroastrians and Jews comes to my mind. In particular, when we queue forward to today's time, the actual lived experience of people not only who live here but also who come from abroad is very different from what is projected as Indian culture abroad. So for example, when people from Africa come here, they face a lot of racism, they face violence. We talk about women, Indian women as well as women who come from abroad, you know, they cannot walk the streets in safety. So when we talk about Indian culture, how can we ensure that from a culture and Indian ethos perspective, how do we reconcile how the lived experience of those who are on the margins of the Indian society and, you know, the high things that we talk about, the good things that we talk about in India? How did we get here? There's a tendency to sort of blame everything on colonialism or, you know, among a certain section to blame everything on the invaders. But we have to, at some point, we have to take responsibility of what we do. So how do we change our culture in a way which makes it more livable for those who are on the margins of society who have less power compared to the others?
Thank you. We will take the last remark from that side, and then we will. There.
Sir Namaskar. First of all, thank you so much for this talk. And I had a different question, honestly. Alok sir had mentioned, you know, different instruments of globalization, that's diaspora, you know, Indian diaspora, stature improved, and instrument of soft power, that's yoga and spirituality and films. My name is Ujwal Nagar. I'm a student of classical vocal, and I'm doing some research on that as well. So I wanted some sort of an opinion of all of you, you know, all of the people in the panel about what kind of a role do you think, you know, Indian musicians or Indian classical music played in globalization of culture, because, you know, music is the, you know, I feel that's one of the integral instruments of, you know, spreading culture across the world. And one more thing I wanted to know, that in current times, how do you feel, you know, sir, Suresh sir, I think I wanted to put a question to you as well, because you have been the DG of ICCR. What has been your experiences in terms of exchange of musicians or cultural exchanges in terms of Indian classical music? Yeah, that's pretty much.
I think as a moderator, I can exercise the privilege of not having to respond to questions. But anyway, I will say something at the end of it. Sir, would you like? Anyway, that is
for both of you. I agree with you that we have a tendency to blame the past. There is a serious problem in this country. I'm not getting into the factors about the enforcement of rule of law. This is a challenge. And culture cannot do that. Look, we all call Ganges our mother, Ganga Maa hai. That belief system alone, sacred, important, it is there. But that didn't stop Ganga from being polluted. The wetlands, which were sacred, are disappearing. The forest, she mentioned that we respect plants. Plants are disappearing. So in almost every field of activity, the aspirations of human beings, in my view, to go ahead exploiting nature, not taking into consideration how it hurts the other people. Now, this is there, and that culture has to handle at that level. But something happening to a student or happening to somebody else is the real challenge before the law enforcement agencies. Now, the other point that I wanted to mention, I think you made about this. Yes, individuals have contributed. You know, from Pandit Ravi Shankar and all kinds of Allah Rakha Ka, all kinds of people have gone at the global stage and made India's classical music a kind of, it can gel with the Western music. But music as a movement is again a major contribution of India. As you know, the Bhakti movement. For 1100 years, it was through bhajan, kirtans and music that the discrimination among the different classes of people, and it started from the south, went up to East Bengal. So music has been our great strength. Now, it should unite us within India. It should go and be of some relevance outside. These are in hands of people like you. Because the state has a role. It has to be sensitive. ICCR has a responsibility. But music as an instrument of change is very powerful. But I find politicians are using that for doing election meetings. I'm not against it, because democracy is very important. I'm not against it. What I'm saying is that music has that multi-dimensional expressions in history itself and also outside. Thank you.
Just a few points I agree with you that I think our ancient ethos talk of actually defending the Sharanagat and looking after that, we have moved away from that. And I think that's why I talked of what Indian culture entails. I think when I talked of liberalism, secularism, all those issues, which we have moved away. Actually, our society is no longer, we have become fairly conservative. It's actually an aberration. Now we need to transform. We are changing. The change may be slow for somebody, but if you actually look at it, what we were 60 years ago and what we are, there is a change coming in the society. It may not be perceptible to, you may not perceive it, but if you look at it, actually you look at dispassionately, go back, read the situation it was 60 years ago, you'll find there's a change. As far as the music is concerned, there's no doubt music can have a very, very powerful emotion. As you know, Ravi Shankar and Beatles did concert for Bangladesh. It actually transformed the public mood as far as Bangladesh was concerned. Till then, there was apathy, actually. That musical concert did it. Why I didn't mention music was, when we are looking at four powerful instruments today, and let me be very emphatic, music is definitely music, cuisine, literature are important ingredients. But as I see, the four most powerful instruments of globalization of Indian culture today are diaspora, yoga, spirituality and films. And I have no doubts about it. Music is a thing, but it does not actually surpass any of these four issues. That's all.
Thank you very much, sir. I mean, I will have the last word then, sir.
I must tell you about one example. I was a young IAS officer in Assam. Mijo Rebellion had taken place in 1966, And there was a committee of the Government of India headed by Cabinet Secretary, and Eastern Army Commander used to be later Field Marshal Manekshaw, and the Chief Secretary. So, and I, my job was to, as a young officer, to record the minutes, not to speak. And they, you know, the problem was that water was down below. The women and men had to carry it from below, and the huts and homes of the Mijo were up in the hills. Now, what did these rebels used to do? They used to hide, and they will shoot the bucket. Now, and water is gone. So again, they, you have to find another bucket now. So what the Government of India decided, as usual, that we will do regrouping of villages. And the army, at very high speed, built 200 homes. So I didn't have that, but I hailed from a village. I knew this is very funny. So they went, and the women of Mizoram are very vocal and very forward-looking. They said, no, this is not acceptable. We will not go to those homes. And you know the logic? They said, the spirit of my father or my father-in-law or grandfather that lives in this tree. I was married on this ground. I will give it up for water. We will go in the night. And those 200 homes, where not a single one was occupied. And that is called community resistance. Because it was such an irrational concept, not considering the local culture. So that happens, even now it is happening. But this requires that kind of sensitivity of understanding. We didn't understand the culture possibly at that time. If the order came, you know how the government functions. Thank you. You yes. Now conclude.
Thank you very much, sir. Okay, as a moderator, I have the privilege of exercising the last or saying the last word. Two or three things. First of all, your remarks about how we treat the African in the country, the women's safety. There are all kinds of issues that you have raised. I think the most important thing, for personally speaking again, and this is coming from my own background, not just as Director General of ICCR, but the way I have been brought up, is that when I was a child, the few values that I was taught is respect for women. My father would tell me that if I touch my sister, for whatever she does, I would get thrashing. I learned that women have to be respected. The power of women, I knew immediately, because in the family, the last word was my mother. It happened. Yes, it doesn't always happen. There are places, there are families where it doesn't happen like this. But this is how I was brought up. The point is that we need to recognize. And that is where I really think your question is, your remarks is a very, very appropriate remark. Recognize that, yes, it's not hunky-dory with the Indian culture. There are ills, there are problems which we need to address. Racism is one of them. Yes, we do suffer from the racism. Africans, it's not basically just because Africans, it's basically because for us, fair skin is the best skin. I mean, you look at the marital attributes, want British is bad. Gori chitti honi chahiye. Ladke ka karan kaisa bhi ho. Kuch bhi ho. Yes, there are problems. But I think there is a greater recognition in the society that we face these problems and we need to address them. I think that is one small step forward. And those are being addressed. Even if slowly, but any sociological transformation takes time. We need to be patient, but we need to be conscious that these things need to change. And please remember that as far as I remember from my own, the Shakti in Indian mythology is Devi. It's a woman. Therefore, in both, all the forms, just remember that, that the Shakti is a female. It's a woman. And I think, I must say that the very first thing that I may not agree with many things that Modiji has said, but one thing that he said is that how many times does a mother tell the son to be careful and not do something wrong? We tell our daughter to be cautious. Ki bhaiya 10 baje ke baad ghar se bahar mat nikalna. Don't do this. We need to teach our sons to be responsible. I think that is happening. Your question about the music. I believe in not exchanges. I believe in dialogue amongst different cultures. And in that sense, I think if you look at the Indian culture, particularly the music, it has been a tradition of dialogue between India, Central Asia, Europe, many, many influences. Sarod has been actually derived from rubab, an instrument from Afghanistan. The Sufism, where does the Sufism come from? Kashmiriyat. Kashmiriyat is a combination of influences in music, the Indian music, Persian, and Central Asian. So it's all there, really. It's all, and I think Qawwalis. What are the Qawwalis? Bhakti movement and Qawwalis and Sufism. There is a great deal of congruence between them. I started a jazz festival in Nehru Park. And if you look at some of the loftiest traditions in jazz music in India, in fact, at one time, the Bollywood music was nothing but jazz. So I think it is there. It's all getting revived now, and we need to be very conscious that ultimately, you cannot insulate one from the other. Till if you insulate one, you put them in a closed room, it will die off. The only way for any cultural metaphor, culture to survive, is to live with others and interact with others. It's a very complex idea. Sorry, sir, I've taken more than what I thought, but this, thank you very much. And a round of applause for the two panelists here.